Would you please pray with me? Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So as Pastor, or as Lee there said when he took the kids, he's talking about forgiveness in Joseph today, so are we. I had a fun little experiment in the sacristy just before church. I said to Alexandra, I said, what do you know about Joseph? I said, do you know who Joseph is? She said, yes, I do. He was the father of Jesus. I said, yes, but not the right Joseph. I said, do you know about any other Josephs in the Bible, like way early on in the Bible? And she said, no. Now, don't laugh at Alexandra. The same is probably true for most of us. Shall I do a questionnaire around here to see who else knows the story of Joseph? Anyone want to volunteer? Joy, you don't count. A few of you don't count. Like if Myra were here, is she here? She wouldn't count. She knows that story too. So here's a bad thing about our lectionary. We wind up getting these little snippets of stories. We got just the 50th chapter, a little bit for the first reading, and then a little bit of Romans, and a little bit of Matthew. And there's like all this baggage that goes with these stories when we only hear the end of them. So I thought I would read the whole story of Joseph leading up to this moment. But the funny thing about that is you can't just hear the Joseph story. You have to find out about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, his father, grandfather, and great-grandfather first. So I thought I'd just read all of Genesis to you. So here we go. Get comfortable. It's a good story. We won't do all of Genesis, but I do want to tell you the story of Joseph this morning. So indeed, do sit back and relax a little bit, because I'm just going to tell you the story. So Joseph was the son of Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Jacob had 12 kids. 10 of them were with wives that were not his chosen wife. And then finally, the last two, Benjamin and Joseph, were the sons of his favored wife. And it's a long, complicated story. Again, that's why I wanted to read to you all of Genesis. But we get to Joseph, again, the son of Jacob, one of 12 kids, and he was the most beloved of the 12. His father, Jacob, loved him the most and kind of, well, let's be honest, he coddled him. He kind of held him above the others, and the others were shepherds out working every day, and I think Joseph would often just get to stay inside with mom and dad and get a lush life. And so the story kind of really becomes Joseph's story when he's 17 years old, and he's out with his brothers, and they're picking up wheat, or they're working out in the fields. And Joseph says, hey guys, I have some dreams I had last night that I want to tell you about. There are these 12 or 11 sheaves of wheat all gathered together, and in the dream, they all started bowing down to me. Hey, there's 11 of you. Oh, I had this other dream too. There's the sun and the moon and 11 stars, and they were all bowing to me. Mom, dad, and the brothers this time. Can you imagine how these stories might have gone over with his brothers? The littlest among them? Well, it wasn't long after that when Joseph was in the house with his dad and the boys were all outside doing their work and dad told him to go out and see what the boys were doing. Go see what your brothers are doing, Joseph. So on his way out, his brothers spied him at a distance and they said, we've had it with him. We're going to kill him. As Joseph neared closer, his one brother, Reuben, said, we can't kill him. Let's just throw him into a big pit and leave him there for dead. Apparently, back in those days in Israel, there were just big pits around where you could throw somebody in and they'd get stuck there. So that's what they planned to do with Joseph. And so he got there. They tore off his nice coat. Apparently, he had a nice coat. Like, it wasn't made out of Skittles or Sour Patch Kids. It was different, but it was nice. They threw him into the pit. Along came some traders heading to Egypt. And again, they had the great idea, rather than leaving him there for dead, they would sell him. So indeed, they sold their brother away. And then they took his nice coat, dipped it in some blood, and went back and told dad that he was mauled by a wild animal. Some brothers, huh? Well, Joseph wound up being taken back to Egypt, where he was then sold to one of the chief people underneath the Pharaoh. And he really worked his way into the Pharaoh's house well. This captain loved Joseph. He was part of his household people. Until one day, the captain's wife took a shining to Joseph and wanted to become quite personal with him, as we shall say. Joseph wanted nothing of that. He didn't want to mess up his great thing he had going on, so he told her no. Well, again, another day, she came at him and wanted to get to know him better. And Joseph said, no way. And she grabbed onto his outer garment, and he ran away, ripping his garment and leaving it there with the captain's wife. the captain, his wife, very frustrated with this situation, had the authorities come and reported to him that he was trying to violate her. Into jail he was thrown. He was in jail for some time when the Pharaoh must have got mad with two of his workers in his house one day, so he sent them to jail also. And they had these dreams in jail. And so the one, the cupbearer's dream, he told to Joseph, and the dream was something to the effect of, there'll be three cups, and then you'll hand the cup to the Pharaoh. And Joseph said, oh, that means that after 3 days, the Pharaoh will call you back, and you'll hand your cup up to him and regain your favor for him. The other guy that was in jail was this bread maker for the Pharaoh. And so after hearing the good report for his buddy, the cupbearer, he said, tell me my dream. I had this dream where I had three loaves of bread, and then birds picked away the bread at the end. And Joseph said, oh, well, that story means that after 3 days, the Pharaoh will call you, and then hang you, and while you're dying, birds will pick your body apart. The Bible's a really nice story sometimes, isn't it? The Bible is tough. So those things came to pass just as Joseph predicted. But yet, Joseph lay in jail by himself. A couple years later, the Pharaoh had a few dreams. Dreams like there were seven ears of corn, seven nice ears of corn, and then seven real skinny bad ears of corn. And then the seven skinny ears of corn ate the big ears of corn. Then he had another dream about cows, seven real strong cows and seven weak cows. And the seven weak cows ate the big strong cows. Well, the Pharaoh wondered what that dream meant. And he asked everybody in the kingdom. Nobody could tell him what the dream meant until finally that cupbearer remembered this guy in jail, Joseph. And so they summoned Joseph out of jail, and he came before Pharaoh, and he said, oh, Pharaoh, I know exactly what that dream means. It means that for the next 7 years, we will have great abundance of produce here in the country. Your fields will be full, your animals will be healthy and full, but then there'll be 7 years of famine where everything will die, and you'll need to save up during those first 7 years. Well, obviously, the Pharaoh loved to have that sort of insider knowledge, insider trading, well before that was a thing, I guess. And so the Pharaoh made Joseph the number two in all of Egypt. And Joseph went around and started collecting all kinds of food during those 7 years. And by the time those 7 years passed, he had built Egypt into this huge abundance of produce and animals and grain, and they were all set. And then just as Joseph predicted, famine hit. And a year or two into famine, all the neighboring kingdoms started coming into Egypt, begging for food, paying for food. And of course, that made Joseph very powerful and very wealthy. Well, one day, among all these neighboring communities and kingdoms coming to Joseph, these 10 men, came to Joseph looking for help. They brought money and the kind words of their father saying, we need help. Well, Joseph met these men, and instantly he recognized them as his brothers. For some reason, they did not recognize him, but he recognized them. He gave them a hard time, as any good brother would. He didn't just give them the grain and sell them their part, but rather he kept blaming them as being spies, trying to figure out why it was they were so successful. But in the end, he gave them their grain and kept one of the brothers with him, Simeon. And he wanted to see this 11th brother they had, Benjamin, his true brother. And so he sent the other 9 brothers away with their sacks full of food and their money back in their bags. So when they got back home, they opened their sacks and saw the food and their money. And immediately they felt guilty. They felt like someone had put the money back in their bags, but yet they would be blamed for taking the money and the food. Well, they grabbed their little brother Benjamin, and they went back to Egypt, back to Joseph. And Joseph, it says in the story, was so overwhelmed and emotional to see his brother, he actually had to leave the room and cry and just weep at seeing his brother again. This time, he sent them all away again with the order to bring back their father, his father he hadn't seen in so many years. And so they went away, and he stuck a silver cup in Benjamin's bag this time, so that when they got away, again, they felt this great blame for not only stealing their money, getting the grain, but also for stealing Joseph's cup. And so they all come back, and they're begging for don't come heavy on us. We didn't steal this. It wasn't our fault. They're there groveling at their brother. And then all of a sudden, Joseph can handle it no longer. I'm your brother. I've missed you all these years. And he falls and just weeps among them. This great reunion, and finally Jacob gets to see his son that he thought was dead for all these years too. Can you imagine the family dynamics there? Missing your son, but about ready to kill the other 11 that knew better, right? And so finally we get to our reading for today. Jacob has died. After all that, he finally gets to be reunited with his son. He's died, but they didn't really work out the details. Just like any sort of dysfunctional family, like all the rest of us, they didn't work out the details of how things would be after dad was dead, the negotiator among them. And so naturally, rightfully so, these other 11 are scared for their lives. The famine is still going on, and they think brother Joseph can just cast them all away. And truly, he can. And so they come to him, and they're like, please forgive us, brother. Don't be like, perhaps another Egyptian would be. And here's what Joseph says back to them. Again, having heard all that story, imagine the words coming out of him after all he's been through. Thrown in a pit initially and left for dead, taken his coat from him, then sold away, and never a thought ever again. And then when they finally do see him, they don't even recognize him. They just probably think he's lost for dead. So here's this moment where they come from him. Joseph says, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do me harm, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So again, have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. He forgave them. He forgave them. I don't know about all you, but forgiveness does not come easily to me. And the funny thing about forgiveness, it's not really about the other person. Joseph forgiving these brothers isn't really about them. I mean, certainly they reap the benefits now of a brother that has much power and is going to take care of them. But when Joseph decides to forgive them, can you imagine the place his heart feels, the way his heart feels in that moment? A number of years ago, we were talking about one of these forgiveness stories from the scriptures in Bible study. And one of my Bible study people said, Pastor, you've talked a lot about this forgiveness stuff and how it's for us. And you're right. Someone in my life I've just been so upset with them for so long, but I forgave them. Like, I truly, put my heart into forgiving them. And I am the better person now. I am the healthy one. And now I can have a relationship with them. Forgiveness, which gets talked about so much in the scriptures, is for you. It's for us. When we forgive, we are set free. When I think of the story of Joseph, I think of how difficult it is for me to forgive some people, and my forgivenesses are nothing like what Joseph went through. Because I know me, and I'm familiar with people, and you all are people, I imagine that there are people in your lives who you have struggled with or have not forgiven. I encourage you to think of this story of Joseph, and I invite you to find it in your heart to forgive those people. As God forgives us, we are called and invited to forgive each other. Amen.